East-West Festival Choir has been working very hard. We've rehearsed three times, and we will present our best efforts to you tonight. But the purpose of tonight's gathering is for us to celebrate our composers, those amongst us who are living composers, who write music, sometimes, как говорится по-русски, stole into the table, or they write music into obscurity and it never sees the light of day, whatnot. And now we are here to celebrate their efforts and to honor them. This is the purpose of this evening's concert. Those of you who are composers in the audience, could you please raise your hands? Thank you. Could I ask you to sit closer to the aisles? We will be acknowledging you. And composers whose music we are performing tonight, before we do your piece, I would invite you to come to the microphone stand here. And if you have the desire, please say a few words about the piece you composed. I'd like to make this less of a formal event and more of an interaction with these amazing people. I will, at this point, ask you to reach into your purses and into your pockets and pull out that wonderful connection to the world that is called the cell phone. And physically take it out and do whatever you need to do to it to silence it. I have a master switchboard. If a cell phone goes off, I press a button and you will be dropped into a chamber below this building where you will undergo rehabilitation. In any case, we welcome you once again and we hope that you will enjoy our efforts. Thank you for coming.
Oh. chambers on the waters.
Fruit of the to say anything, and I found out about this a few minutes ago, so I don't have anything prepared. But I did want to say that it seems for as long as I can remember, and Father Segay can corroborate this, there's been talk in America and American Orthodoxy about American Orthodox music. As long as the church has been singing in English, which has been about 4 or 5 decades now. So the question has always occurred, what kind of national musical expression might music of American Orthodoxy take? As I said in my talk this morning, I'm not a composer, so I don't normally go spending a lot of time composing new works. But somehow, this melody that you heard today, Christ is Risen, just came to me a few years ago, and I carried it around inside me for a few years before I wrote it down and arranged it. And it occurred to me that for America, something that is grounded in folk song, and in this case, specifically Appalachian folk song, which is pentatonic, as you heard, and then also something that is grounded in the Sacred Harp tradition, the shape note singing tradition, which is very indigenous to America, which many people know, which is experiencing a bit of a revival these days, that it would be a very appropriate expression for American Orthodox music, not necessarily exclusively, but certainly that fortuitous combination seemed to happen in that Christ is Risen. So it's wonderful to have heard it sung by you all, and I think this is the kind of music that, because of those folk elements, resonates in people's hearts, and that I think is a very important aspect of any kind of church music, that it resonates spontaneously in the heart. So those are my thoughts. Thank you.
Before the
actually for the choir, but not for you. We're going to keep you here. My name is Kurt Zander. I'm the chair of the music department here, and I'm also the symposium director for what we're hosting right now on the campus of NKU, which is the 2014 Pan-Orthodox Liturgical Music Symposium, which is a conference dedicated to Orthodox choral music composed in the English language, some of which you're hearing tonight. We have 22 states represented in two provinces from Canada, and some of you, of course, are here with us tonight, and some of you are visitors. I'll talk a little bit about the symposium, but I wanted to say just a few words about the piece that we just sang, because obviously Arvo Pärt is not here. But I know a little bit about Arvo Pärt's music. I've studied it extensively. And I just want to tell you a little bit about his life, because it's a little bit different from a lot of what we think of as Orthodox composers. Pärt was born in Estonia in 1934, and he was born not an Orthodox Christian, grew up in then the Soviet Union under very strict creative kinds of controls. If you were a composer at that time, you had very little access to the kinds of scores and music that they were composing in the West. You were lucky if you got a copy of something by Copland or Bernstein, but chances are you really didn't know what was going on, or if you did, you couldn't really get a score to study it. Pärt was raised in pretty much what we call the Soviet avant-garde, which was very dissonant kinds of music. He experimented in a lot of different kinds of techniques, 12-tone technique, collage technique. That was all through the 60s, and he wrote some very striking and stunning music using that technique. But then something incredible happened. He stopped writing altogether. It was around 1970, 1971, when he just stopped and couldn't write another note. And he spent that in that state as a composer for about 4 or 5 years. Until in the mid-70s, I think it was 1975, he emerged with a very simple piano piece. The piece was called Für Alina, and it was written for a little girl. And the piece consists of nothing more than, if you're musical, you understand this terminology, triads and a simple scale based on all white notes of the piano. And to him, it sounded like bells. He called this style tintinnabile, which means little ringing bell. And it's a very simple style, but it's one that has enormous application to many different things. Everything that he wrote from the 70s on was written in this tintinnabile style, including the piece we just heard. Without getting into too much analytical about what the tintinnabile style is, it's a way of allowing the text to compose the music. Now, it sounds easy, you just put a formula in and out it comes. But one of the beautiful things about Pärt is that you're really not aware of the process. But there is a process. And the process is based, in most of his compositions, on the number of syllables in a word. And that's not different from how a Byzantine chant, and in some cases Russian chant, is composed. It's based on the syllabic content of the words. And that drives how you compose the music. Now, Pärt believed that various languages each have their own character. And Pärt wrote in six languages that I know: Spanish, Latin, German, English, Slavonic, what was the last? German, yes, Berliner. So six different languages, and each is different. And if you think about it, the English language is very different from Latin, it's very different from Russian. Very different because it has single-syllable words, a lot of single-syllable words that other languages don't have. So he wrote an English piece, and the effect is very different. Now, this piece that we just sang is in Church Slavonic, which is a liturgical language similar to Russian, similar in sound to Russian with some differences, but it has a lot of different syllabic stresses that change the kind of music that you hear. So if you hear Pärt writing in English, it sounds somewhat different than Pärt writing in Church Slavonic or Spanish. So one of the things that also is a hallmark of Arvo Pärt's music is the silence, the use of silence. And it's not a passive silence, it's an active silence. when we were rehearsing this piece, the first time we ran through it, it's very hard to get your brain around it because there's these pauses. And Maestro Yermolov did an exercise with us. He says, okay, let's just do these pauses and we'll make them passive silences. Just sing and stop, sing and stop. And he said, now I want you to sing and put energy into the silence. Now, if you closed your eyes, I bet you could still tell the difference. I know that seems mystical, but there was a substantive difference in how that sounded, even the silence. And from that point on, we understood the piece a little bit better. So Parrott's a fascinating composer. I had the privilege of meeting him in England at one time and seeing where he composed. And he sits in a room with no pictures on the wall and just one icon. And it's in a little upright piano. It's not a huge grand piano like we have here. It's a very simple little house on the outskirts of England near a monastery, which is where he spends his summer. So if you get a chance to buy more Alvaro Parrott's music, he's a very popular composer. And that's the last thing I want to say about him is that he speaks to millions of people. He's one of the most famous living composers of all time, which says that the music that we sing as Orthodox speaks to other people, not just people who understand Orthodox, but there is something about it that resonates with other people. And that's a great thing for us as composers because we have an untouched audience out there sometimes that can be moved by our writing. All right, I want to tell you a little bit, while they're resting their voices, just a little more about what we're doing here. I don't need to rest. Yeah, you can hear them. Some of the music you're hearing tonight was the result of a composition competition. If you're a composer out there and you've majored in music, we're all well aware of composition competitions. They're all over the place. They're for symphonies, they're for this, for that. But rarely do you find composition competitions for Orthodox choral music. And even more rare is Orthodox choral music written specifically in the English language. So we put a call out for scores, knowing that the symposium was coming up, way back last year sometime, I forget the exact date. And we received scores from all over the world. Some from Bulgaria, some from Finland, some set English better than others from over the pond, but a lot from this country. From people who were not very old, people who had spent a lot of time writing music, people who maybe never really composed a whole lot. We got a whole bunch of stuff. And some of the music you're hearing tonight is the result of the call for scores, the scores that we received from people. And this was all done not just so that we could feature this music, which is beautiful music, and that's a great part of it. But the part of this symposium is that we're encouraging people to believe that you can write music, that it is possible to sing music that is by living people. And I know you classical music bands deal with that concept of music of dead white men. Orthodoxy has our own challenges in that regard. We sing music by a lot of composers who lived well over 100 years ago. This is not totally our fault. It's partly out of necessity, partly out of what we were given when we started churches in this country. But I think we've reached a new place in Orthodoxy in the English-speaking language where we can look to our own people for writing music. And you're hearing some very beautiful music tonight. And these are some composers that have decided to dip their toe in the creative world of Orthodox choral music. And I'm privileged to be singing this music and to be having you share this music with us. So. I will see how we're doing back there and see if they're ready to come out again. But thank you for coming, and please do visit the kiosk outside, the little store outside with Orthodox choral music. I do have a CD, a little shameless plug here, I do have a CD of my music out there with some of the music that you're going to hear tonight. But there are also scores and there's books about Orthodox choral music that you might want to pick up. So thank you again for coming.
Oh.
This piece is dedicated to another composer on this program who unfortunately is not here tonight, who's to come but was prevented at the last minute. His name is Nazo Zaka, and you'll be hearing his music later in the program. I heard this piece on a recent CD called Panagia by the Archangel Voices, conducted by Dr. Vladimir Morosan. I'll plug this CD. I'm not on the CD, but it's available at the kiosk. And when I heard this piece to this same text by Nazo Zakak, I was so moved, so touched, and I couldn't get it out of my head, out of my soul. I was impressed by its simplicity and its profundity.
I wanted to answer it. And so this is an answer to it. Also in a simple form, I think it was Chopin that said, simplicity is the final achievement. And I think Arvo Pärt, in his post-silence, was also trying to find that simple, profound music. So here it is.
Thank you.
Richard Tensing in your prayers. He's come down with a serious illness and could not be with us. I think he would appreciate that. Mark, would you be willing to say a few words?
Hello?
The next piece you're about to hear is a piece I wrote partially from need and partially from artistic whim. I've worked with a lot of choirs as a conductor, and I've worked also as a chanter for a few churches. Got very acquainted with Russian chants, which I sang for many years. And this piece is very influenced by those chants. And with the various choirs I've worked with, both professional and non-professional, this piece was written mainly for the hobbyist singers, the non-professionals. The intention was to not make something terribly complicated, yet still have a certain degree of artistic innovation, and hopefully this will appear in churches and choirs, hopefully to help inspire prayer and liturgy.
What Mark didn't tell you is that out of all the scores that we received, we sent all the scores out to three judges, and the judges came back with the unanimous decision that Mark Rabinka's Anaphora was the winner, the winning prize composition. And it's a beautiful piece, and it's I know Mark spent a lot of time in the monastery in New York, and you can really sense the monastic beauty of this piece.
Thank you. not a loud voice. You know, we all use different techniques when we try to compose something. With most of us, the text comes first. And when I try it, I take the text and I keep on thinking about developing a rhythm. But this one didn't come about because of that process. It came back, it started with listening to a TV program, Law and Order. because the composer used a synthesizer. So, you know, I never used any of those instruments in Finale. So I went downstairs to my office, took out, made a score up, and I started by using chord progressions, single whole notes for eight measures. Hey, that sounds pretty good. Okay, put it away, and I save as experiment synthesizer. Okay, the next day I went back and I started putting passing tones in there. All of a sudden the melody's converging. But it's not the melody you're going to hear tonight. So I thought, I wonder if I could use some kind of a liturgical text in this. Something nice that's going to be long drawn out. And Cherubim Hymn came into mind. Now the original key for this was by the way, the key of F. Now you can see the problem with the key of F is sopranos and tenors. So I, after I finished, I put it down, you know, the Finale, you just have to take one click and you can bring the whole thing down any key you want. So I brought down the key that we're going to be singing you today. Because I thought this would be the key that a, quote, regular church choir could possibly handle. It's not too high, it's not too low. Well, there's some low notes there. And then I thought, you know, it's very slow. And I thought this would be a nice way of maybe singing it in church. The choir is very subdued, and the priest is singing, is reciting those prayers before the communion, before the great entrance, so that you have a background of sound for the priest reciting his prayers. Hopefully, I have achieved that. Thank you.
Thank you.
poser. I'm an imposter. I'm a church singer my entire life. I've spent, I think, on choir loft. And maybe this is an example of remembering that our words are important to those around us, both what we say in unkindness, but more than that, what we say in kindness. Many, many years ago, a singing Orthodox friend of mine said, "Why don't you become a choir conductor?" Years later, I did. And the only reason I did that was because somebody said something about it and brought it to mind. It made me want to achieve that. About a year and a half ago, I was honored to have one of the litanies that I wrote for my own women's choir that I never thought would go any farther than the choir room or the choir loft with my choir, was used at an Orthodox conference up in Montreal. And walking down the hall after service, Dr. Kurt Sander said, "We need to hear some more music from you. So you've got to watch what you wish for." Because I always wondered what the troparium to theophony would sound like in tone 7, because that's my favorite tone. I joked about petitioning the church fathers, but that's not really possible, I guess, only in prayer. So this was just a whim to see what the troparion of theophony would sound like in tone 7 rather than tone 1. And I got a little carried away. So, then when after I wrote it, I was embarrassed to show it to anyone, but when Dr. Kurt Sander announced a competition for church music and he said he wanted to see more music from me, I sent it in. And I guess a dream come true would be that a wonderful, wonderful choir like this, with these wonderful, wonderful singers, in this room filled with people that I respect so greatly and admire and look up to, and a wonderful, wonderful conductor, and Dr. Kurt Sander, and everybody here in this community, is just a humbling honor beyond words.
Oh, minutes before the program if I was nervous. And I confess that I was very nervous. Nobody outside my own parish has ever heard any of the music that I arranged or composed. In this case, harmonized, Papadobin, that I learned from a man who had a great deal of influence on me. When I became Orthodox, I was in Boston, and I just moved there. And I drove up to the cathedral on Park Drive, and a little VW, I had a hard time finding, by the way, that the park and everything really makes it confusing. Anyway, this little VW drove up in front of the church, and this guy hopped out of the Beetle, and it looked exactly like Jerry Garcia. And it was Archbishop Joe. And I don't know if you know anything about his musical preferences. He didn't like Russian music yet. He only liked Carpathian Russian music. And this melody, tone two, is for O House of Ephrathah. And if those of you, most of us sing, in the Russian tradition, we sing the Volum chant because it fits the words so much better in English. You can't fit the words to this melody. So he hated Russian music so much that he harmonized to this melody, Ispolati Despota. So when the choir director said, Bled by Vika, that's the only one we know. The Archdeacon Roman, also of blessed memory, could pull this one out and say, here. But anyway, so. And the composing process started by just thinking about my choir, which is pretty strong. There's 16 very good singers, and they're composed of second sopranos and baritones. Yeah. I have one genuine tenor who I had when I composed this, but he since was ordained to a priesthood and now no longer is in my choir. So anyway, so I'm begging you, composers, think about the average little parish where you haven't got true sopranos. You may not have a true bass. And to write something that fits within our humble standards. Thank you. Thank you for sitting.
Father Edmund Moody, and they were commissioned by our Society of St. Romanos in Chicago. We commissioned an entire liturgy from Father Ivan, and one of the patrons of our society who donated for the commission, her husband passed away, and so she requested some funereal pieces. One of them we'll do today. And then I was corresponding with Father Ivan, and I just threw out a flippant phrase. I said, "Father, are you in the mood to write anything Lenten for us?" And lo and behold, 2 weeks later came this piece by Father Liam Brace, which is just a marvelous, marvelous work. And he said he composed it in 4 hours or something of that nature. So that speaks to his prolific talent. And we're delighted to share this work.
Thank you. all of the singers tonight for doing such a great job in such a short amount of time and doing putting your heart into the music. I'd like to thank Mr. Guillermo Hoff for conducting tonight. I'd like to thank all of you for coming, and don't have a whole lot to say about the last two pieces. The first is written in Church Slavonic, and it's a hymn to the Virgin Mary, Theotokos, Virgin Mother of God, Virgin Theotokos, rejoice. And the last piece is, I can think of no better way to end the program than a hymn to the resurrection. And this is the angel cried, telling about the angel proclaiming the resurrection of Christ. If you listen carefully and you know the Tropar to Pascha, you might be able to hear it in here somewhere.
Oh,
Can all the composers please come to the front of the stage? We have something special for you. Please come. Composers. Only composers.
Benedict and Peter and Reason.